Will you stand with me as we go before the Lord and let's ask him to open up our eyes. Father, thank you for the incredible truth that you've given us, that you've penned it and you've written it for us. And Lord, it's timeless. Rizpah lived 3,000 years ago and we live in the 21st century, and yet it is as relevant today as it was when you wrote it down and the events of her life. So I ask, Father, that you'd begin to speak to us, that we would have ears to hear what you want to say to us for 2017. And through this event and through this life story, Lord, teach us those things that you want us to hear in the next moments of our lives on this Sunday night. And we thank you and we give you praise in the name of our King Jesus. Amen. So in 2 Samuel chapter 21, we look at the story and it begins. I'm in 1 Samuel. Let me get to 2 Samuel. Are y'all there? If you don't, I have it up on the overhead. I'm not going to read all of it, but I am going to give you an outline of what happened here. So let me read the first verse in chapter 21 of 2 Samuel. Now there was a famine in the days of David for 3 years. David is now king. Saul and Jonathan and his whole house has been killed. They have been disposed of and deposed, and David is now sitting on the throne of Israel, all Israel, not just Judah, but all of Israel. And something has happened. He's had prosperity and he's had a wonderful time, but now there's a famine, and this famine isn't just 1 year, it's 3 years. And when you live in an agrarian culture and you depend not on water systems but on rainfall, and that's what they did 3,000 years ago, they were agrarians, they raised crops. When it doesn't rain, you don't have food. And if you don't have food, your stock isn't fed, your house isn't fed, there's nothing to trade with, and you go into depression and famine. Are you with me? That's why it says, well, there was a famine in the land. There was a drought. There was a famine in the days of David for 3 years, year after year. And David inquired of the Lord, and the Lord answered, it is because of Saul and his bloodthirsty house, because he killed the Gibeonites. So the king called the Gibeonites and spoke to them. And the Gibeonites were not of the children of Israel, but of the remnant of the Amorites. The children of Israel had sworn protection to them, but Saul had sought to kill them in his zeal for the children of Israel and Judah. Now let me just stop there. This is about a broken blood covenant. Now the word testament is a transliteration of the Latin testamentum. New testamentum, new testament, new covenant, new blood covenant, old testament, old blood covenant. A blood covenant was the most solemn binding agreement that is known in all of the universe, and God instituted it. And the blood covenant was between two parties. And when you entered into a blood covenant, you had to keep that covenant, and the word covenant itself in the Hebrew means to cut. And you would take an animal and or several animals, and you would cut them in half, and you would have one half on one side and one half on the other, so that the blood ran between them. And then you would do the blood walk with that partner, and you would say, so be it unto me, if I do not keep the terms of this blood covenant, may I be like these victims that are dead and sliced, because the blood flowed. And where blood is, that's a signal of death, because the life of the flesh is in the blood. So when you see blood, something's died. Are you with me? So way back, 400 years before this ever happened, Israel had made a covenant with the Gibeonites when Joshua went into the promised land. Do you remember Jericho? Well, and then do you remember Ai? Well, anyway, Ai was another battle, and it was another victory after they lost and after God was with them. And the Gibeonites had heard of what had happened and seen what had happened to Sog and to Og and Sion on the other side of what had happened to Jericho. And so they went to Joshua and into the camp of Israel. And they fooled them. They had old clothes on. They had musty bread. They had old wineskins. And they said that they were a people from far off. And that it took them all this time to travel into this camp, and that they wanted to make a covenant of protection with Israel. And Joshua did not seek the Lord. He didn't ask of God or inquire of him. And he made a covenant in God's name with the Gibeonites. They quickly found out that the Gibeonites had fooled them, that they were just the city down the street. They were slaughtered. They were to be slaughtered and destroyed. But because of the blood covenant in the name of God, in the name of Jehovah, in the name of Yahweh, they had to honor it. Are you with me? God honors his covenant. God keeps his word. And God is a God of justice, and it may take 400 years, but God will be justified, and he will bring judgment when there is sin and when there is disobedience. In America, we had better stand up and take watch, because there is blood on our hands, and that's a whole nother story for a whole nother season. But Israel was guilty of bloodletting. Saul, in his zeal to be king, had almost wiped out the Gibeonites. And because of the blood covenant, there was famine and there was drought. And so when God inquires, and when he answers David, when David says, what's going on? How come we're not blessed? God says it's because of the bloodthirsty and the bloodletting of Saul and his family and his reign. All of Israel encouraged him to do it. So David goes to the Gibeonites. And the Gibeonites say to him in verse 4, and the Gibeonites said to him, we will have no silver or gold from Saul or from his house, nor shall you kill any man in Israel for us. So he said, well, whatever you say, I'll do it for you. How can we get this fixed? How can we bring justice here? Verse 5, then they answered the king, as for the man who consumed us and plotted against us that we should be destroyed from remaining in any of the territories of Israel, it was almost a genocide, verse 6, let 7 men of his descendants be delivered to us, and we will hang them before the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, which was, by the way, Saul's hometown. Gibeah of Saul was where Saul was from. We're going to hang these 7 descendants of his up in his home city. And they had gone on to say, and they said, and the king said, I will give them. So David now has the responsibility of letting vengeance come into the hands of man because of a broken covenant. God's out of the picture. He has to honor it. Are you understanding this? Because otherwise it could seem crazy. Are you with me? So God now is backing this blood covenant because it was made in his name. Saul has tried to wipe out the Gibeonites. The Gibeonites now want blood for blood, and they want retribution. And they say, we don't want money. We don't want you to kill anybody in Israel, but we want Saul's descendants. We want 7 of them. So here's where the story gets good. Well, it's not good, but here's where we can learn. But the king, okay, so let 7 of his descendants, verse 6, be delivered to us, and we will hang them before the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, whom the Lord chose. And the king said, I'll give them. But the king spared Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, because of the Lord's oath that was between them, between David and Jonathan, the son of Saul. Jonathan and David had made a blood covenant of friendship. And so David spared Mephibosheth, his son. He was not one of the 7 that was going to be handed over. So the king took Ammoni and Mephibosheth. Obviously, it was the name of the time, you know, like Ryan and, I don't know, some man's name. Mephibosheth was a popular name. This was another Mephibosheth. Can you look at your neighbor and say Mephibosheth? Say it 5 times and use it in a sentence really fast. Yeah, good luck with that. So David now is handing over 7 of Saul's descendants, 2 of his sons and 5 of his grandsons. So David hands over 2 sons that belong to a concubine, and her name is Rizpah. So the 2 sons of Rizpah, the daughter of Aya, whom she bore to Saul, and the 5 sons of Michal, the daughter of Saul, whom she brought forth for Adriel, the son of, I don't want to go into those names because I can't say them. We'll be here all night, me trying to sputter through this, but let's just see what's happening. Rizpah was a concubine. A concubine was a secondary wife, and her sons and her daughters were descendants, but they were not ever going to be on the throne. She was someone that was probably beautiful, because you're not going to be a mistress or a concubine of a king unless you're looking good and you're a number 10. Would you agree with that? Probably, right? So Rizpah is one of many of Saul's concubines and wives. She has 2 sons. That's all she has. And then she has 5 nephews, which are 5 of Saul's grandsons. And they were birthed by Saul's daughter, Merib. And she had 5 boys with this father. And so Saul's 5 grandsons and 2 of his sons through Rizpah are handed over to the Gibeonites. And the Gibeonites take them to Saul's hometown, Gibeah. Let's see what happens. In verse 9, and he delivered them into the hands of the Gibeonites. This is verse 9. And they hanged them there on the hill before the Lord. So they crucified them. They killed them and then they hung them up. They didn't put nails through them. That didn't happen until Rome. But they hung them up on a tree. They killed them and they were hung up. And they hanged them there on the hill before the Lord. So they fell, all seven together, and were put to death in the days of the harvest, in the first days, in the beginning of barley harvest. That is April. So this is happening in the month of April. So we're seeing that Rizpah is a classic victim. She didn't do anything wrong. She just minded her own business, had her boys. She was trying to live her life. And suddenly, her five nephews and her two sons are grabbed, taken to the hometown of Saul, her husband, who is now dead. And they are killed and they're hung up and crucified. Well, not crucified, but they're hung up on trees there as spectacles. Okay, that's what's happening. Pretty gory, pretty bad, would you say? All right. That's why you don't hear a lot of sermons on this. All right. Now Rizpah, verse 10, the daughter of Aiah took sackcloth and spread it for herself on the rock. From the beginning of harvest until the late rains poured on them from heaven. Now remember, there was no rain. So when the rains come, the drought's broken. The famine is over. Are you with me? So she has a rock, and this rock was a high place because Gibeah was only about 6 miles north of Jerusalem. And there was a high place there where they worshiped God, and it wasn't a place of idolatry. It was a holy place, and there on that place, that rock, she takes sackcloth. Now, who knows what sackcloth is? It's kind of like a very rough burlap, and sackcloth represents mourning and poverty and humility. When you put yourself in sackcloth, you were mourning or you were humbling yourself before God, right? She's a widow. She's a concubine. She takes sackcloth. She's got this big old rock, and there in front of her are her seven boys, five of them nephews, two of them sons, and she puts sackcloth on this rock from the time of the barley harvest, which is April, in time of the latter rains when they finally came, which was 5 months later. Wow. She sits on that rock and lives on that rock in front of these dead boys. Dead men. They're not boys. They're men. Verse 10. Now Rizpah, the daughter of Aiah, took sackcloth and spread it for herself on the rock from the beginning of the harvest until the late rains poured on them from heaven. And she did not allow the birds of the air to rest on them by day, nor the beasts of the field by night. And David was told what Rizpah, the daughter of Aiah, the concubine of Saul, had done. Then David went out and took the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan, his son, from the men of Jabesh-Gilead, who had stolen them from the streets of the Philistines. And he brought up the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan and the bones of these boys, and he gave them a proper burial, and then the rains came. What in the world have we got to learn from this horrific, heartbreaking story of a woman who is a classic victim? Through no fault of her own, she is now staring at her dead family and all of her inheritance and all of her hope and everything that she has ever had in her life that meant anything is now hanging before her, dead. Now, if she can do this and do something, then there's something that God wants to say to you and me about my life and your life and the walk of faith. Because faith is a substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things that we don't see. And faith is the method that God takes the supernatural and he brings it into the natural world. The just shall live by faith. You and I are going to need to operate by faith. That's how we are to live. We don't live by the natural of the sight, the sound, the hearing of the ear, the smell, the taste, the touch. Those are our five senses that we are given so we can navigate in this corporeal world. But the supernatural realm where God is in and where he is taking us, we are spiritual beings having an earthly experience. We are going to have to learn to operate by faith in the Son of God and by faith in God Almighty. And Rizpah is a classic perfect example of how to take the most negative situation in your life and turn it around and cause a nation to actually come under the blessing of God, because you are about to do three things that I just want to bring you tonight that she did that if I put into my life can change. So it may be a bad story, but there's good that comes out of it. And it's there so that I can see that things aren't as bad as I think they are, and that God has a plan in the midst of all this hell. And if I'll just hang in there, then things are going to turn around. And it even turned a king and a nation. And it brought the blessing of God in the rain. So let's see what she did. Three simple things tonight. The first thing, if I'm going to learn from Rizpah and learn that, listen, life isn't fair. It never will be fair this side of heaven, but God is. And then none of us are victims. Not one of us, if you are born of the Spirit of God, are any longer a victim. You know what a victim is? I had my son look it up for me. A victim is someone who is injured, harmed, or killed through an event or circumstances or people through no fault of their own. Victims. There are predators and there are victims. God says we're not victims. We are victorious and more than victorious and overcomers by the blood of Jesus Christ. So here's this woman that is a classic victim, but she did something. She did something so crazy. So absolutely crazy. And if you look her up online and you look at the books written about her, it's about the mother's love. Oh, yes, it's about the mother's love, but it's about a woman on the edge that says, finally, I'm saying no. And the first thing she did is she made a stand. Listen, you don't make a stand. You don't decide to choose to do something different in your life, to do something because of the injustice, then nothing is going to change. Because if you don't make a stand, if you don't stand up for what you believe in, then you're going to fall for everything. Sit there and lick our wounds and be weak. I live in a nation where everybody gets an award. Every team at the soccer field gets an award. I live in a nation where if you say the wrong thing, the wrong way, and the wrong tone, they're offended and you are no longer politically correct. I live in a nation that is so weak that we're offended over silly little words about what color our skin is, whether we're crackers. That's me. Whether we're Latinos, whether we're Asian, whether we're African. Listen, we are one blood. This is just the outside. But on the inside, we are humanity made in the image of God. One blood. Doesn't matter what color you are. That's just your outside coloring and your landscaping. But we're all the same on the inside. There's two models, male and female, and that is it. There is not model number three somewhere in there. She made a stand. She stood up for what she believed, and she stood up, and she made her spot, and she accepted her spot. Now, what's a spot? A spot is where life puts you. A spot is where you belong. If you're a mother, your spot is to be a mom. That's your spot. If you're married, your spot is to be married to that other one, whether you're male or female. If you're the husband, then you're the head of your house. That is your spot. If you're the woman, then you come under the authority of your husband. You are a team and you agree together and you believe God together, but we each have spots. If you're working for an employer, your spot is to make him as successful as you can. That is your spot. You hearing me? If you're a student, your spot is to learn everything you can learn from your teachers. That's your spot. You see, our spot is where life puts us, where God has us. She chose her spot. It was on a rock in front of decaying, dead bodies, but she took a stand. She said, I am not going to let my boys stand and rot and not have a decent burial. I couldn't do anything about their lives and about them losing them, but I can do something about how they're going to be buried. Now, it just happened to say that in the law, see, she had the word behind her. In the law of God, in Deuteronomy 21, 22 and 23, this is what God had said. If a man has committed a sin deserving of death, and he is put to death, and you hang him on a tree, did that not just happen? His body shall not remain overnight on the tree, but you shall surely bury him that day. so that you do not defile the land which the Lord your God has given you as an inheritance. For he who is hanged is accursed of God. She had the law behind her. She had God's word behind her. Yeah, they were killed in front of her. But how come they didn't take them down? Why didn't they bury them? So she took sackcloth and she camped on that rock from the beginning of the barley harvest, which is April, all the way until those latter rains came, which is 5 months later. And from morning till night, 24 hours a day, she stayed in her spot and she made a stand and she wasn't going to stop. Listen, what are you willing to put up with this year? What do you tolerate? What does God say you can have, but you don't see it in your life? You see, she had no ability to change the circumstances of their death. But when she made a stand, she now entered into the supernatural realm of faith. And now she had the ability to change how they were going to be buried. They were either going to be buried or not buried, but God said they deserve a burial. What do you put up with? What do you tolerate? Kids that are going haywire? An illness, a bad report from the doctor? A marriage that is ripping apart? Poverty and finances that just tear you up and there's never enough money to pay the bills? What are you tolerating this year? And you've tolerated, you got through 2016, but now here you are, 2017. And RISPA teaches me that when you make a stand and say, that's enough, that's it, I'm done. I'm camping out right here and I am not budging until I see a change. You see, you got to make a stand until you decide that you don't want it anymore in your life. You don't want the devil playing racquetball with your brain, messing up your marriage, taking your kids to hell, giving you no favor so you can't even pay your bills. Listen, it is the will of God, men. It is the will of God that you have jobs and that you feed your families. That's the will of God for you. God has the word on it. It is the will of God, women, that you be blessed and you prosper. And if you want to be married and have a family, that God blesses your family. My children are in the ministry, but they weren't always good kids. Some of them were real rascals and they took us to hell and back. But I learned from RISPA that I got to make a stand and I got to make a decision and I got to choose. I'm going to live on that rock for 5 months and I got to start there. I asked God, please calm me down so I can just talk to these people tonight. Oh, I'm so sorry. Do we live to exist, or do we exist to live the God kind of life? Do we live to exist, or do we exist to live the God kind of life? So first and foremost, make a decision. What are you putting up with that God says you don't have to anymore? Make a stand. Number two, take courage. Courage is something that I have to take. I have to take it because it's a gift from God. Courage is something that I can't muster up in myself. Oh, I have human courage. And we all have some form of human discipline. And you can look at all of the pump-up videos on courage and great things that mankind can do. But I'm not talking about that kind of courage. I'm talking about the kind of courage that is supernatural. That pushes you into a whole nother realm of living. That takes you where you never thought you'd go and helps you to do what you never thought you could ever do. And it takes you into a place that you never dreamed you would be. And that's going to take courage because nothing in our life is going to be easy. It's going to be a fight. And there are no even pathways on the road of faith. You and I are going to be in a battle. So I'm going to have to learn how to take courage. And the courage that I'm talking about doesn't come from my own spirit and my own circumstances and my own abilities. The courage that I'm talking about comes from one source and one source only, and it's God Almighty. It is God Almighty. Now, how do I get that courage? Let me just read you a couple definitions. You all right with me? Courage, also known as bravery, will, fortitude. Let me give you just a Webster's definition. Is the ability to confront fear, pain, risk, danger, uncertainty, or intimidation. Physical courage is the courage in the face of physical pain, hardship, or threat of death. While moral courage is the courage to act rightly in the face of opposition, shame, scandal, or disappointment. That's the natural courage. But courage, that I'm talking about comes from God, because this woman fought off the fowl of the air and the beasts of the field all day long, all night long for 5 months, a little woman. Now, do I have that picture? Here's a picture, it's an artist's rendering of Rizpah. And there's the boys, there's the men, dead. Their bodies are decaying. Body decomposes very quickly. So here she is on this rock, and the fowl of the air and the beasts of the field, she's fending off, and she's not letting them devour the corpses of these five men. Now, I don't know about you, but if you just think about, I'm a woman, and I can be very fearful, especially of eyes in Africa many times, and it's a very dangerous place. I've gone on safaris, I've done many, many things, and I've put myself in danger a couple of times because I was foolish. And these beasts are beasts that can eat you and take you out. We don't live like that here. We have coyotes, possum, raccoon, fox, squirrel. We have crow, eagle. But we don't have the kind of beasts that are going to devour you. But they did. David killed a lion and a bear. Remember when he rescued his lambs out of their jaws? So just think about this for a second. Israel was a place where there were beasts that could devour and kill you. And the fowl of the air, the unclean, the vulture, the eagle, the raven, these are birds of prey that want to devour and want to swoop down on these corpses. And she is fending them off all day long. And then at night, she's warding off the night beast, the beast. That takes some kind of courage, don't you think? And she did it alone. There's no record of her family being with her. I don't see a list of people that are on that rock with her. I don't know where she got her food or where she got her water. I don't know if her relatives said, oh, she's lost it. She's a woman on the edge. She is over the edge. She's gone crazy. She didn't care. See, when you make a choice and you make a stand about something, you don't care anymore what people think or what people are going to say about your life, because you've got a word from God, and God said those boys should be buried, and they weren't buried, and she was not going to leave them devoured by the fowl of the air or the beasts of the field. So for 5 months, she's fending them off. Now, I said courage comes from God. Courage is not the absence of fear, but the presence of faith. We've got to go to the source of faith, which is God and His Word. When you are afraid, you have access. That's why you've got to take it, to be with the Creator of heaven and earth. When you are conscious, of His presence, when you are conscious of His protection, when you are conscious of His favor and love for you, then you're not afraid anymore. You're not afraid anymore. Now listen, danger is very real, but fear exists in the imagination. Fear is images of things in the future that could never happen. But God's given us imagers, right? You have an imagination. That's why words are so important to you. You're made in the image of God. He's given you an imager. You can image. You can think a thought, and that thought forms a picture, right? So fear exists in the imagination, and it is about something in the future that hasn't even happened or could possibly never happen, but it can paralyze us and stop us from doing what God wants us to do. Make no mistake, danger is very real, but fear is an illusion in the future that is not yet real in our lives. Worry is to fear what hope is to faith. It forms an image on the inside of your imager of what can be, and it's not bad, it's good. It's not something to take you out. It's something to put you over. It's not something to devour you and cause your life to be a failure, but God's word and his promises and the hope that it brings begins to paint a picture of what God wants for your life, a whole family, a dynasty, children that are going to be what they're supposed to be, better than you could ever dream, and that you will be prosperous and successful in your life as a man and a woman of God. It doesn't mean you have to be rich. I'm not talking about money, but I'm talking about being successful. I'm talking about the blessing of God. I'm talking about fulfilling your spot and what God's ordained for you. Fear will take you out. It's not even real. Hope will put you over. And courage comes from God's word. God told Joshua in Joshua 1:8. Can I have it up there? I know these are old scriptures, but we got to feed on them because this is where truth is. This book of the law, when Joshua's about to go into the promised land, he's got a group of second generation from Egypt slaves, Israel. They're not an army yet. And they got to take out walled cities and giants. And this is what he says to Joshua, not to all of Israel, but to Joshua. He says, the book of the law, the word of God, shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. Next verse, for then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Listen, it's going to take courage to do something that God wants you to do. It took courage for David to run towards Goliath and say, you uncircumcised Philistine. It took courage for Jochebed, Moses' mom, to defy Pharaoh's edict to throw him into the Nile. And she made a basket for that little boy. And on his third month, she sent him off into the Nile with the crocodiles. And it took courage for her to believe that God was going to save him. It took courage for Esther to stand before her husband, that crazy king that hadn't summoned her in months. And if you go into the king's presence without his invitation, you are instantly dead. It took courage for her to walk through that courtroom and to go to her husband. And it took courage for her to make intercession for her people. It took courage for Peter and John and James to preach the gospel. The time of Rome, when the Jews wanted to kill them, it took courage for Paul to stay in a prison when he had the dispensation of grace on the inside of him and he wanted to go into all the world. It took courage for him. It took courage. It's going to take courage for you to live in the 21st century. It's going to take courage for you to do what God wants you to do. It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be pretty. It's not going to be pleasant. But God has made us tougher than we think we are. We can stretch further than we think we can stretch. God doesn't want a bunch of famous celebrities. He wants some heroes of faith that he can trust with the kingdom of God. I read something by Rick Warren. And Rick Warren said, we are very confused in this generation about what's a celebrity and what's a real hero. He said it was brilliant. He said, celebrities are famous for being famous. The difference between a celebrity and a hero is their sacrifice, the reason for their sacrifice. He says, a celebrity, an entertainer, an athlete, an actor, a businessman, will sacrifice for what they can get. There's benefit coming back to them. Money, fame, fortune, pleasure. But a hero, sacrifices for someone else without any strings attached. Nothing's coming back. It's just for someone else. You see, I believe Rizpah is a hero. I believe that that woman did not have to stand on that rock for 5 months. I believe she could have looked up at those men and she could have said, what? But you see, she took courage from God. She had a promise. She had a word from God that they're supposed to be buried. They're dead, but at least I can do is get them the right burial. Maybe that's where you are tonight. Man, your life's a mess like mine was. But when you make one stand and you make one choice and one decision, God meets you there and then he takes you by the hand and he says, come on, baby, I'm going to show you what you could never believe. But you got to make the choice. You got to take courage. Courage is not the absence of fear, but the presence of faith. He says, come boldly to the throne of God. Come boldly. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. When you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change. When you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change. when you change the way, when fear is no longer a part of your life, the only thing you fear is God. When you change your perspective and how you're looking at that problem, listen, what you look at the longest has become strongest in your life. Let me say it again. What you look at the longest becomes strongest in your life. When you look at the problem and fear is allowed to stay in your spirit, in your heart, then the problem becomes the giant. But when you begin to look at God, how? Through meditating His word, through listening to what He says, to understanding the supernatural God of the universe. He says, my word is life and its spirit. He said, as the heavens are high above the earth, and as the rain comes down and waters the earth, so shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It will accomplish what I send it to do. You see, first was the thought, and then was the word, and then was the creation. God said, and the Holy Spirit created. God the Father conceived. God the Word commanded, and God the Spirit created. Are you with me? When you are born of the Spirit of God, you are now in the kingdom of God, and now God is in you to will and to do His good pleasure. So He's conceiving His plan in your life. The Word is coming out of your mouth, and the Spirit of God is now giving you the grace to make that thing happen in the supernatural. It's the same thing, but you've got to take courage. What you look at the longest is going to become strongest. She's looking at dead boys, and she's not going to give up. And she's fighting off anything that's going to destroy them. That tells me I can be courageous. Danger's real, but I don't have to live in fear. God's with me. Number three, stay in your spot. Don't quit. This is such a simple message. This woman was 5 months on a rock, looking at dead men, fighting off the fowl of the air and the beasts of the fields for 5 months, day in and day out. For 5 months. Let's see, that's about 150 days. She stayed on that rock by herself 24 hours a day. She didn't quit. She didn't stop. You see, when you make a stand, when you begin to say, okay, I'm not going to tolerate this anymore. In 2017, I'm putting a stop to this, God, because I have a promise from you, and your word says it can be, and therefore I'm going to release my faith and I'm going to believe it because your word has the power to bring itself to pass. Just like there's a tree, an oak tree, and an acorn, there is the promise already in the seed of the Word of God. It's already there. It just has to be planted in a heart of faith, and it will begin to grow. It cannot do anything but do what God sent it to do. But it needs a heart of faith. Faith is a force. It has to come into you and go out of you. Are you with me? You're going to have to make a choice. Take courage from God. When He's with you, you're not afraid of anything. So start developing this year the presence of God. How do I do that? You read His word. You talk to Him. You meditate on His word day and night. You turn off the TV. You turn on Joel Osteen or whatever you're going to listen to on the radio or whatever you're listening to online. And you begin to let your spirit feed on the supernatural word of God because it's spirit and it's life. And it begins to form an image on the inside of you. And the seed begins to grow in you. And the promise becomes more real than the problem. Are you with me? And number three, stay in your spot. She didn't leave. Do you think she had opportunity to say, what am I doing here? Looking at dead decaying bodies and thinking, have I lost my mind? They're dead. They're decomposed. I'm crazy. Why am I here? So they can have a burial? They're already dead. You see, she could have quit through monotony, boredom, disappointment, discouragement. All those lists of things that will happen in your walk of faith when you make a stand and you begin to take courage because of the risk that it's going to take in your life. Now is going to come the test of boredom, the test of monotony, the test of no change, the test of obscurity. Nobody even knows I'm here. Nobody even knows why am I sitting on this rock. But you see, that's not true because God knows you are where you are. God knows you're releasing your faith. God knows you're taking courage. God knows you're doing what you're doing. And you keep on keeping on doing what you're supposed to do. Because in 2 Samuel 21, verses 11 through 14, and David was told what Rizpah, the daughter of Aiah, the concubine of Saul, had done. So she may have thought nobody knows what she's doing. She's in Gibeah. David's in Jerusalem. There's no internet or news. Channel 7 wasn't there. Fox News was not there. CNN was not there. She's alone. But David was told what Rizpah, the daughter of Aiah, the concubine of Saul, had done. Then David went and took the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan, his son, from the men of Jabesh Gilead, who had stolen them from the street of Bethshan, where the Philistines had hung them up. These group of men did a very courageous thing. The Philistines had killed Saul, gutted him, done horrible things to his body and Jonathan and his sons, and they slept in, or they crept in at the night, and they stole the bodies, and they buried them in a secret place in the city. And David knew where these bones were buried. So David went and took the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan and the men that had been stolen. And so he brought up the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan, his son, from there. And they gathered the bones of those who had been hanged. They buried the bones of Saul and Jonathan, his son, in the country of Benjamin, in Zelah, in the tomb of Kish, his father. So these bodies now are all gathered together. And they're put in a tomb, the tomb of Kish, because Kish was Saul's father. So now they go to their homeland, and they go to their family plot, and they're all buried together. They buried the bones, and they performed all that the king commanded, and after that, God heeded the prayer for the land. After that, God heeded the prayer for the land. The curse was broken. The rains came. Israel was blessed once again because one woman wasn't afraid to make a stand and live on a rock for 5 months just to bury her sons. One woman, one little concubine, wasn't afraid to fend off the fowl of the air and the beasts of the field because she wanted a dignified burial for the ones that she loved and her inheritance and her family that was dead in front of her. One woman, day in and day out, looked at their faces and looked at their bodies as they decayed, and she stayed in her spot. She didn't quit. She didn't leave. She didn't say, it's too hard. I can't take it. Nobody knows what I'm doing. Why am I doing this? She didn't let doubt, obscurity, boredom, monotony. She didn't let any of that stop her. She was there. That was her spot. And until it was finished, she stayed put. What is God saying? Make a stand. What are you living with that you don't have to? Is it broken dreams? It's time to dream again. Time to dream again. Maybe bad things have happened, but God's bigger than bad things. One widow, one concubine turned a nation and a king around. Make a stand. Take courage, because courage can only come from one place. It's in the presence of God, and you stay close to him, and you do it through his word first, because when you begin to devour his word, and you may not know what it says or understand what or know what it means, the Holy Spirit's your teacher, and if you'll cry out and say, God, help me. When I was young, 39 years ago, I didn't know anything. How did I get from absolute despair into marrying Jim Cobrae and in Lake Arrowhead and starting a new life? It was because God took me and gave me courage and had a plan for my life. And I went one step at a time with him. And I devoured his word. I went to every service. I lived in house ministry. And he was everything to me. You see, when he becomes everything to you, you don't think the Holy Spirit is going to open up your ear and open up your understanding so that when you begin to read the word, boom, boom, a message is going to come, boom, he's talking to you, boom, I understand, boom, doors are open, boom, doors are closed, boom, it's frightening, I'm scared, it's risky, but oh, there's courage, because you know God's in it. And stay in your spot. Some of you want to bolt and run. Of course you do, it's hard. But it's not time yet. You stay until it's finished. When it's ready for you, the king will hear of what you're doing. And the king will turn it around. And that king is Jesus. So make a stand. Take courage. Stay in your spot. Watch God turn your life, your family, this nation around because of your faith. I so tried to be calm. I'm glistening again. A 66-year-old woman, a grandmother sweating in front of you like a little pig. Oh, it's all the sugar cookies I ate at Christmas. Oh, the Word of God is so full of life. Some of you are so young. You're just starting out. What an adventure lies ahead of you. Some of us have less days in front of us than behind us, but there's still great adventures. God says that young men will dream or have visions, and old men will dream dreams. Why do old men dream dreams? It's not because they're sleeping. It's because they've already lived the dreams that they dreamed, and now God's got a fresh and a new one, even in their old age, to bring to pass. He's never done until our eyes close and we get to go home. I don't know all of you tonight. I'm way out of time, and I've talked too much and probably beat you up a little bit, and I'm sorry. But listen, God is the most amazing, incredible Father. He loved you so much that he just wasn't about to have heaven without you. So he had a plan. He sent a son. The Word made flesh. That's why Christmas around here is so exceptional, because we just celebrate that the God of the universe, the Word, stepped into the womb of a virgin and became the last Adam, became a man so that he could walk through the human experience. He could get to that cross. That was his spot. Because he was holy and pure and had no sin, he went through every temptation you and I will ever go through, successfully overcame it. And he was qualified to be the Lamb of God. He was the only one qualified to take the sin that I had committed, the sin that you've committed, the sin of this world on himself, so that God could take us. And as we look at that cross and believe that he is who he says he is. Believe that he's the Lamb of God. Believe that he came. Believe that he died. Believe that he took our sins on himself. And believe that because he's God, death couldn't hold him and the grave couldn't keep him. And he says, no man takes my life from me. I lay it down and I pick it back up because he's God. And the gates of hell could not hang on to him because he was an innocent man. And he rose from the dead. And if you will look to that cross and you will believe and surrender your life like I did 39 years ago, maybe it's a mess. Maybe you're here tonight and you say, oh, you don't know what I've done. No, I don't, but God does, and he is not in therapy over your sin. Maybe you're thinking, I don't trust myself. I've made commitments before and I break them. I'm just terrible. Listen, you've never made a commitment and let God give you the power to keep it, because you can't keep it on your own. It's a gift like courage. You have to take salvation. It's already been given. You just have to receive it. How do I receive Jesus Christ? How do I make him the Lord of my life? Well, it's something that you have to do in your heart. It's your human will that has to say, I believe and I surrender. Here's my life. Maybe I don't get it. Maybe I don't understand it, like I didn't 39 years ago. But I knew Jesus Christ was real. I knew he was who he said he was, and I knew that I had to give my heart and my life to him, regardless of what was going to come. And when I surrendered my heart and my life and said, be my Savior and be my Lord, he came into my life and I was never the same. And that's what I'm inviting you to do tonight. If you've never surrendered all of your heart and all of your life to Jesus Christ, you're here by divine appointment. God knew where you'd be tonight. He brought you here to listen to this old grandma. And he says, will you come? Will you just let me be the Savior? Because you can't save yourself. And the Lord, Lord means boss of your life. And let me take the reins. You see, he can't force himself on you, but he will come as soon as you invite. And that's what I'm doing, is I'm giving you an invitation. I can't save anybody. I can just tell you how to do what God has already done. And you have to take it just like courage, because he's already given it. Now you have to receive it. So with every eye closed and every head bowed, I'm going to ask you in this place just to have a private moment, just a gift of privacy. No one's looking around, and it's just you and God. If you were to die, would you know where you'd go tonight? Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You see, God didn't make you for hell. He made you for heaven. But if you haven't received Jesus Christ, if he's not Lord and Savior, then you are destined for hell. And that's why God brought you here, because he didn't make you for hell. He made you for heaven. But you have to receive it. If you've never surrendered all of your heart and all of your life to Jesus, I'm talking to you. Maybe you've backslid. Maybe like me, you were raised in the church and you loved God, but oh my gosh, have you gone the wrong way with the wrong choices? I'm talking to you. God brought you here tonight. So all over this auditorium, if you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm talking to you. If you've never surrendered all of your heart and your life to Him, I'm talking to you. If you backslid and you knew Him, but now you're not serving Him, it's time to get right with God. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to count to three with heads bowed and eyes closed, bang like that. And I'm just going to ask you to lift your hand with no one looking around. This is between you and God. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands if you need to get right with God. Raise them high so I can see them. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. Raise them high. Wave them at me. So I see that hand. 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 In the family rooms. There's not a lot of people here tonight, but there's a lot of hands. All right, this is what I want you to do. You meant what you said, like Rizpah. You're going to make a stand without any embarrassment. But from your heart, as we stand and as we sing this last song, because we're going to close this service out, I want you to grab your purse, your Bible, your husband, your wife. If you raise your hands together, your kids, I want you to slip out of the aisle. I want you to come and meet me right here. And we're going to get right with God tonight. And you're going to change destinies. And you're going to give eternity a welcome because you were made for eternity. Now come and receive Jesus Christ. If you didn't raise your hand, you can come with the rest. It's not too late, but quickly get up here. God is calling you home. He made you. He loves you. He's not mad at you, but you must receive Him on His terms, not yours, not mine. So quickly come. Quickly come. Quickly come. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by giving your heart and your life to Jesus Christ. No one can make you come. Come on. I'm not selling knives at the county fair. I'm giving an invitation to change your destiny and let Jesus Christ be the Savior and the Lord of your life. You raise your hand. Now let's get right with God. Don't start out your life in rebellion. Come. I can't make you come. I counted at least 8 hands and not one of you have come up. That's bizarre to me. That's bizarre. Are you embarrassed? If you're embarrassed in a place that's been praying for you and loves you, look at me, I make a fool of myself. How can you walk out those doors and how can you live for Jesus Christ? If He can die naked on a cross, we can't walk an aisle and say, I'm confessing that You are Lord in my life. He said, if you confess Me before men, I will confess you before My Father. But if you do not, I will not. Now let's get serious because this is life and death. You don't have tomorrow, but you have today. If you raise your hand, get your little butts down here and let's get right with God now. Now, come on. I could tell you stories. I could read you letters of people that didn't come and now are in prison. And they wrote us letters and said, tell them to come. I wish I would have come because now I'm in prison for life. Justin wrote us that letter in 2016. 8 of you raised your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4. There's 4 more of you, but come on, let's go. What, am I pulling teeth?
Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're mine.
Do you know what He's done for us? Well, I've worked hard. I have contended with unbelief and fear in this auditorium and rebellion. One day I'm going to stand before heaven and I'm going to stand before my King. And I want to hear a well done. Because you can't care what people think. You got to learn to obey what God says to do. Because if you have a fear of man, you will never have a fear of God. When did God tell us to be people pleasers? He said, fear God and nothing else and please God. When you please God, then everything else will fall in order. I'm going to give you one more chance. You need to get down here right now. I just need you to get down here now. Oh, God, the Holy Spirit is not letting me go. He's not letting this service end just because He loves you so much. You are one stubborn little heart, but He loves you. He says He's not disappointed and He's not angry, but you need to get right now. You have tonight, but you don't have tomorrow. Now is the day of salvation. Whoever you are, you need to get down here. There's three of you that need to get down here right now. God has stopped this service, and I am willing to be a fool for him. Where are you? And get your little butts down here, or your big butts, or whatever you are, male or female. Just get down here now. We're going to give you one more chance. Come on. There's one. Where are the other two? There's some men in this house that need to get right with God. And this old grandma's a nag. Make a stand. Take courage. Come join your spot in eternity with God. All right. Oh my goodness, I can be very scary. Listen, look at me. You're not going to a funeral, you're going to a party, a birthday party. It's yours. He didn't make you for hell, he made you for heaven. And you have angels that were assigned to you when you were born. And it says that they look on his face. And it says that angels rejoice when a sinner returns and comes home and gets saved. Does that, you know what they're doing? They are dancing and having a party. That was my little robot dance. But you don't get saved by walking an aisle or raising your hand. You get saved by inviting him into your heart. And we want to take a moment with you and do that personally and privately. Is that all right? So if you'll make a left turn, this is Pastor Joel. We have a very wonderful place to take you. It won't take long, but we want to pray with you personally because we want you to know what you're doing. And we want you to remember this moment. So if you just make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel. Welcome to the family of God. Pastor Dan, do you want to close us out tonight? With Vision Sunday? Do you love our senior pastor?